Talk Sport Clips of the Week.
But we thought we'd do a special today, the best of Mike Parry, a homage to his contribution over the years. Some are classics, some are ones you may not have heard. I'd not heard some of these for a second time. The producer dug them all out yesterday. Let's kick off now with one of the classics.
Well, I enjoy a packet of peanuts with a pint of shandy.
I know where you're coming
now
from.
Now, I want to know what the peanuts are first. So people think I'm mad. I go into the pub and say, hi, how are you doing? What can I get you, sir? I said, well, first of all, what sort of peanuts do you sell?
I've never quite worked out how that happened.
It'd be a strange opening gambit in any pub.
It would be.
I'm now for Mr. Parry to take us on a food tour of the north of England.
Now, what is Burnley really famous for, Michael?
Eccles cakes.
And here's another one.
And, of course, Lancashire, the home of the Lancashire hot pot, the home of roast beef and Yorkshire pudding.
Pardon? No, don't think so. Now for a very odd theory.
The rucksackers are something we're going to talk about during the course of this show in the next few weeks. Rucksackers, to me, are the dearth of human civilisation.
Rucksackers? It's not a phrase I've ever heard.
Is it a band?
Maybe it's a band that he really doesn't like. They're not sort of shoegazy indie band, were they, the Rucksackers?
Yeah, I think they were from
pale little kids, tight jeans.
Early 90s outfit, disappeared in the end. But I wouldn't say they were the dearth of civilization. They just weren't very good.
They had a difficult second album. Yeah. But I think that's all you could really say about them. Here's Mike now with a cry for help.
I love the trees, you know, particularly in the autumn when they're shredding leaves, particularly in the spring when the wind picks them up and they're waving at you. You stand on your balcony there and the trees are literally waving at me. They're swaying in the wind. I wave back at them, you know.
Pardon? Where's Mike Parry? Oh, he's waving at the trees.
What's he waving at? The trees, I'd imagine.
Oh, yes, Mike waving at the trees in the wind. Don't worry about Mike.
Okay, in this clip, we really think Andy Townsend should stop egging Mike on.
The one I find odd is when you go into these little shops, and they're just corner shops, they've got a machine there saying, get money out of here.
And they never work anyway.
Well, even if they do, I'm a bit suspicious that there's a little, you know, there's not a man in there. And as soon as you push your, your card in, he takes a note of your number and then pushes it out again. And you get a few quid. Mm. I mean, you know, they're very odd machines, those.
Well, they are.
Don't egg him on by saying they are. Just put him in his place.
Come on, Andy. He thinks cash machines are sort of like R2-D2.
He does. They kind of walk off.
Inside, making your personal details.
Getting a calm drive off with your money. Time now for a biology lesson.
Drink salt water, Andy. Your tongue goes bigger than a loaf of bread in your mouth.
I'm not sure that's strictly true. And that's why he never got the Tomorrow's World gig, I think. Yeah. That was the problem for Mike.
Is he medically trained, or is it more just layman stuff?
I think he's just guessing.
He's just
a
an enthusiast.
Lot of this stuff.
Yeah. Okay, from biology, let's go to geography.
Who came runners up to Lyon in the French League last season and are now in the Champions League?
Biggest time, but say Bordeaux, Mike.
Bordeaux, as in the tapestry, yeah?
Yeah.
No, I think you'll find the pair of you.
The lesser-known Bordeaux tapestry. Yeah, the great tapestry.
It's a good tapestry.
No, Bayeux tapestry, but it's a good tapestry.
Yeah, it's one of my favourites. As tapestries go, it's right up there, yeah. But it's in the top 10, but certainly not the best. During this rant, we hear Mike beginning to unravel slightly.
One from John who says, "A Boogie Wonderland by Earth,
Boogie
Wind and Fire.
Wonderland.
Yeah, good song. Yeah.
I never liked Earth, Wind and Fire very much.
Why not?
I thought they were a bit sort of, sounded to me like the sort of group that you'd come across in the middle of the Amazon forest. You know, like, a bit local, really. You know what I mean? No, you know what I mean.
How
can
a band in the Amazon forest be described as a local
band?
Well,
you know, they used a lot of, like, wood and cymbals and that kind of stuff. Like a, you know, like a rural sort of, what am I trying to say here?
Yeah, do you know what?
Nobody knows.
You know, if you actually analyse, Mike has a point in his intro. If you analyse, they did used to use a lot of odd kind of African instruments. They would have those, and a lot of the intros on the album, they'd have these kind of... Look, okay, I'm just trying to get... I don't buy that.
No, yeah. I mean, they wore a lot of caftans.
Yeah, they were into a sort of mystical stuff.
I think most bands utilise wood.
Yeah, but no,
To be fair, it sounds more like he's thinking of Clannad. Well, he's probably got muddled up with Clannad, hasn't he?
A local band. Anyway,
local band for local people.
Give us another one.
Time for another classic now.
Yeah. Let's go to James, who's a Man United fan in Sheffield. Hey, goodness me, James, is that you? Are you there?
You're on Mars.
Andy's favourite clip of all time, though. And this is certainly his favourite Mike Parry, You on Mars.
You on Mars.
Now, Mike has got this amazing ability to... Or to sing badly. But he proves, and we're going to play you three of Mike Parry sings. And on the last one, I still maintain it's genius because he comes up with fresh lyrics, and you could argue actually better lyrics for the song to Rod Stewart's Do You Think
like
I'm Sexy?
It's like 8 Mile with Eminem. This is off the top of his head.
Yeah.
And it is freestyle lyric writing that you wouldn't have heard before.
But in the mainstream. So a couple of them he's just singing, but the final one, listen to him reworking the lyrics of Do You Think I'm Sexy? Take it away, Mike.
Then do you want me to give you the first line, Andy?
Go on then.
Dirty old river, da 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 da. It's that one, isn't it?
I'm off to the sunshine. And again from Michael, the French referred to...
Don't talk about the sunshine. Don't talk about the daytime.
If you think you have what it takes and you want to be one of the two challengers to give Anthony a run for his money tomorrow, then the song you need to work on is Do You Think I'm Sexy by Rod Stewart.
So let me just give you a few bars of that.
Go on then.
If you think I'm sexy and you're done to love me, come on baby, open wide. If you think I'm groovy and you want to smooch me, come on, baby, by my side.
Yeah. Rod would have been proud of those. They were actually more suggestive than the original lyrics, weren't they?
Yeah, almost to an extent it makes you feel a bit uncomfortable.
Now, listen, mate, I want to talk to you about the sick note culture in this country.
The sick note culture?
Yeah, sick note culture. Now, how do I link Piers Morgan
to sick note culture? We used to be known as the sick man of Europe, didn't we?
We used to be known as the sick man of Europe, but I think that was more, that related actually, Mike, more to the industrial strife of the 70s when we were always on strike. But the sick note thing, let me give you some figures and facts. And the reason why I highlight this is because this could drag the country down at a time when, you know, economically we could be on the up.
And also, you're not feeling very well.
I'm not feeling well, but I don't tell you, Tom, I've never had a dry feel in my life. I mean, obviously, apart from
apart from the 8 month spell when you were in intensive care or whatever was going on.
But I had acute heart failure.
Yeah, but you can't then say, I've never had a stick.
No, what I'm saying is, I've never rung up the office on a single day of my life. It said, I'm not well enough to come to work today. I'd go to work if I was on a stretcher, right?
Well, you didn't go to work when you were on a stretcher.
Well, no, I did, because I didn't, because I couldn't breathe. I was wired up to a heart machine that was pumping blood around my body to keep me alive.
Yeah.
Now then, what I'm saying is, this has reached a crisis point where we spend £9 billion a year now subsidising people who are on the sick. £9 billion.
When you say on the sick, do you mean like long-term sick?
Yeah.
That kind of thing?
Yeah. Yeah. How about this? Long-term sickness, right, more than 1 million people in this country, that's 1 million, Mike, million people, that would fill Wembley Stadium 12 times over, right?
Yeah.
More than 1 million people take sick leave for over a month each year, and that costs the economy £9 billion. Now, do you know what I'd do?
What would you do?
For £9 billion... I would literally form a new organisation called the Health Police, and I'd have these people literally investigating all claims for long-term health
sickness. Well, isn't this what the Tories and the Lib Dems are trying to do?
Well, they've got to get real about it.
Yeah, they have.
I mean, for £9 billion is about nine times the budget of the Metropolitan Police.
Yeah.
Now, if you think about it, just think of what sort of investigative process you could build with £1 billion.
Yeah.
A huge organisation. I would have people trained to SAS standards, right?
But the trouble is, reason that they have such a difficulty in kind of in making these people kind of sit down and explain exactly what's wrong. Yeah. If you say you've got a bad back, you say you've got, you know, neck problems, you say you can come up with all sorts of things that are wrong with you.
Sure.
But are quite difficult to kind of diagnose.
I know, but you see what I'm saying, I would train people to SAS standards of reconnaissance.
Oh, yeah.
Of reconnaissance. So, for instance, I had a mate once when I was working in Ireland during the Troubles, the hunger strikes and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
The height of the Troubles, very dangerous, of course.
Of course.
Very dangerous to be down the Old Falls Road dodging
your
the petrol bombs and all that.
Your life was probably in danger every single minute of the day.
It could have been, well have been.
Yeah.
But I had a mate who I met later who was in Army Intelligence, and he lived in the loft of a house for a week.
Really?
Right, yeah, which he drilled little holes through the ceiling to put miniature cameras in to spy on the people below who were suspected provo terrorists. No.
It's illegal.
Well,
you get
an order from a judge. You get an order from a judge.
Yeah, but if they're suspected terrorists, but not if they're just long-term sick.
Well, I think we should do that. I think we should have SAS-style reconnaissance.
I don't want people in the loft.
Yeah, well, no, you don't, but you're not trying to cheat the country out of money by pretending you're sick.
Yeah, but I don't want people in the loft generally spying on people anyway. It's not like Eastern Germany you're talking about.
Do you know
about like the Stasi here?
Well, I'll tell you which other way you could do it.
Yeah.
You can go to the house next door if it's a semi-detached or terrorist house, and you can drill those holes through the walls of the house next door, put miniature cameras through.
Yes,
you should, because you've just said it's so difficult to pin somebody down if they're complaining about a backache or something like that.
It is.
Well, you could soon produce evidence to a court that these people were very active, leaping over the couch at home.
And that would cost another $9 billion.